Transposition by C.S. Lewis. In the church to which I belong, this day is set apart for commemorating the descent of the Holy Ghost upon the first Christians shortly after the Ascension. I want to consider one of the phenomena which accompanied or followed this descent, the phenomenon which our translation calls speaking with tongues, and which the learned call glossolalia. You will not suppose that I think this is the most important aspect of Pentecost, but I have two reasons for selecting it. In the first place, it would be ridiculous for me to speak about the nature of the Holy Ghost or the modes of his operation. That would be an attempt to teach when I have nearly all to learn. In the second place, glossolalia has often been a stumbling block to me. It is, to be frank, an embarrassing phenomenon. St. Paul himself seems to have been rather embarrassed by it in 1 Corinthians, and labors to turn the desire and the intention of the church to more obviously edifying gifts. But he goes no further. He throws in almost parenthetically the statement that he himself spoke with tongues more than anyone else. And he does not question the spiritual or supernatural source of the phenomenon. The difficulty I feel is this. On the one hand, glossolalia has remained an intermittent variety of religious experience down to the present day. Every now and then we hear that in some revivalist meeting, one or more of those present has burst into a torrent of what appears to be gibberish. The thing does not seem to be edifying, and all non-Christian opinion would regard it as a kind of hysteria, an involuntary discharge of nervous excitement. A good deal of even Christian opinion would explain most instances of it in exactly the same way. And I must confess that it would be very hard to believe that in all instances of it, the Holy Ghost is operating. We must suspect, even if we cannot be sure, that it is usually an affair of the nerves. That is one horn of the dilemma. On the other hand, we cannot, as Christians, shelve the story of Pentecost or deny that there, at any rate, the speaking with tongues was miraculous. For the men spoke not gibberish, but languages unknown to them, though known to other people present. And the whole event of which this makes part is built into the very fabric of the birth story of the church. It is this very event which the risen Lord had told the church to wait for, almost in the last words he uttered before his ascension. It looks, therefore, as if we shall have to say that the very same phenomenon, which is sometimes not only natural, but even pathological, is at other times, or at least at one other time, the organ of the Holy Ghost. And this seems at very first surprising and very open to attack. The skeptic will certainly seize this opportunity to talk to us about Occam's razor, to accuse us of multiplying hypotheses. If most instances of glossolalia are covered by hysteria, is it not, he will ask, extremely probable that that explanation covers the remaining instances too? It is to this difficulty that I would gladly bring a little ease if I can, and I will begin by pointing out that it belongs to a class of difficulties. The closest parallel to it within that class is raised by the erotic language and imagery we find in the mystics. In them, we find a whole range of expressions, and therefore possibly of emotions, with which we are quite familiar in another context, and which, in that other context, have a clear natural significance. But in the mystical writings, it is claimed that these elements have a different cause. And once more, the skeptic will ask why the cause, which we are content to accept for 99 instances of such language, should not be held to cover the 100th as well. The hypothesis that mysticism is an erotic phenomenon will seem to him immensely more probable than any other. Put in its most general terms, our problem is that of the obvious continuity between things which are admittedly natural and things which, it is claimed, are spiritual. The reappearance, in what professes to be our supernatural life, of all the same old elements which make up our natural life, and it would seem, of no others. If we have really been visited by a revelation from beyond nature, it is not very strange that an apocalypse can furnish heaven with nothing more than the selections from terrestrial experience, crowns, thrones, and music. That devotion can find no language but that of human lovers, and that the rite whereby Christians enact a mystical union should turn out to be only the old familiar acts of eating and drinking. And you may add that the very same problem also breaks out on a lower level, not only between spiritual and natural, but also between higher and lower levels of the natural life. Hence, cynics very plausibly challenge our civilized conception of the difference between love and lust by pointing out that when all is said and done, they usually end in what is, physically, the same act. They similarly challenge the difference between justice and revenge on the ground that what finally happens to the criminal may be the same. And in all these cases, let us admit that the cynics and skeptics have a good prima facie case. The same acts do reappear in justice as well as in revenge. The consummation of humanized and conjugal love is physiologically the same as that of the merely biological lust. Religious language and imagery, and probably religious emotion too, contains nothing that has not been borrowed from nature. Now, it seems to me that the only way to refute the critic here is to show that the same prima facie case is equally plausible in some instance where we all know, not by faith or by logic, but empirically, that it is in fact false. Can we find an instance of higher and lower where the higher is within almost everyone's experience? I think we can. Consider the following quotation from Pepys' diary. Quote, "With my wife to the king's house to see the Virgin Martyr, and it is mighty pleasant. But that which did please me beyond anything in the whole world was the wind music, when the angel comes down, which is so sweet that it ravished me, and indeed, in a word, did wrap up my soul so that it made me really sick, just as I have formerly been when in love with my wife, and makes me resolve to practice wind music, and make my wife to do the like." 27 February, 1668. Close quote. There are several points here that deserve attention. One, that the internal sensation accompanying intense aesthetic delight was indistinguishable from the sensation accompanying two other experiences, that of being in love and that of being, say, in a rough channel crossing. Two, that of these two other experiences, one at least is the very reverse of pleasurable. No man enjoys nausea. Three, that Pepys was, nevertheless, anxious to have again the experience whose sensational accompaniment was identical with the very unpleasant accompaniments of sickness, and that is why he decided to take up wind music. Now, it may be true that not many of us have fully shared Pepys' experience, but we have all experienced that sort of thing. For myself, I find that if during a moment of intense aesthetic rapture one tries to turn round and catch by introspection what one is actually feeling, one can never lay one's hands on anything but a physical sensation. In my case, it is a kind of kick or flutter in the diaphragm. Perhaps that is all Pepys meant by really sick. But the important point is this. I find that this kick or flutter is exactly the same sensation which in me accompanies great and sudden anguish. Introspection can discover no difference at all between my neural response to very bad news and my neural response to the overture of the magic flute. If I were to judge simply by sensations, I should come to the absurd conclusion that joy and anguish are the same thing, that what I most dread is the same with what I most desire. Introspection discovers nothing more or different in one than in the other. And I expect that most of you, if you are in the habit of noticing such things, will report more or less the same. Now let us take a step farther. These sensations, Pepys' sickness and my flutter in the diaphragm, do not merely accompany very different experiences as an irrelevant or neutral addition. We may be quite sure that Pepys hated that sensation when it came in real sickness, and we know from his own words that he liked it when it came with wind music, for he took measures to make as sure as possible of getting it again. And I likewise love this internal flutter in one context and call it pleasure, and hate it in another and call it misery. It is not a mere sign of joy and anguish. It becomes what it signifies. When joy thus flows over into the nerves, that overflow is its consummation. When the anguish thus flows over, that physical symptom is the crowning horror, the very same thing which makes the sweetest drop of all in the sweet cup also makes the bitterest drop in the bitter. And here I suggest we have found what we are looking for. I take our emotional life to be higher than the life of our sensations, not of course morally higher, but richer, more varied, more subtle. And this is a higher level which nearly all of us know. And I believe that if anyone watches carefully the relation between his emotions and his sensations, he will discover the following facts. 1, that the nerves do respond, and in a sense, most adequately and exquisitely, to the emotions. 2, that their resources are far more limited, the possible variations of sense far fewer than those of emotion. 3, that the senses compensate for this by using the same sensation to express more than one emotion, even as we have seen to express the opposite emotions. Where we tend to go wrong is in assuming that if there is to be a correspondence between two systems, it must be a one-for-one correspondence, that A in one system must be represented by A in the other, and so on. But the correspondence between emotion and sensation turns out not to be of that sort, and there never could be correspondence of that sort where the one system was really richer than the other. If the richer system is to be represented in the poorer at all, this can only be by giving each element in the poorer system more than one meaning. The transposition of the richer into the poorer must, so to speak, be algebraical, not arithmetical. If you are to translate from a language which has a large vocabulary into a language that has a small vocabulary, then you must be allowed to use several words in more than one sense. If you are to write a language with 22 vowel sounds in an alphabet with only 5 vowel characters, then you must be allowed to give each of those 5 characters more than one value. If you are making a piano version of a piece originally scored for an orchestra, then the same piano notes which represent flutes in one passage must also represent violins in another. As the examples show, we are all quite familiar with this kind of transposition or adaptation from a richer to a poorer medium. The most familiar example of all is the art of drawing. The problem here is to represent a 3-dimensional world on a flat sheet of paper. And the solution is perspective. And perspective means that we must give more than one value to a 2-dimensional shape. Thus, in a drawing of a cube, we use an acute angle to represent what is a right angle in the real world. But elsewhere, an acute angle on the paper may represent what was already an acute angle in the real world. For example, the point of a spear or the gable of a house. The very same shape, which you must draw to give the illusion of a straight road receding from the spectator, is also the shape you would draw for a dunce's cap. As with the lines, so with the shading. Your brightest light in the picture is, in literal fact, only plain white paper. And this must do for the sun, or a lake in the evening light, or snow, or human flesh. I now make two comments on the instances of transposition which are already before us. Number one, it is clear that in each case what is happening in the lower medium can be understood only if we know the higher medium. The instance where this knowledge is most commonly lacking is in the musical one. The piano version means one thing to the musician who knows the original orchestral score, and another thing to the man who hears it simply as a piano piece. But the second man would be at even a greater disadvantage if he had never heard any instrument but a piano, and even doubted the existence of other instruments. Even more, we understand pictures only because we know and inhabit the three-dimensional world. If we can imagine a creature who perceived only two dimensions, and yet could somehow be aware of the lines as he crawled over them on the paper, we would easily see how impossible it would be for him to understand. At first, he might be prepared to accept on authority our assurance that there was a world in three dimensions. But when we point it out to the lines on the paper and try to explain, say, that this is a road, would he not reply that the shape which we were asking him to accept as a revelation of our mysterious other world was the very same shape which, on our own showing, elsewhere meant nothing but a triangle? And soon, I think, we would say, "You keep telling me of this other world and its unimaginable shapes, which you call solid, but isn't it very suspicious that all the shapes which you offer me as images or reflections of the solid ones turn out on inspection to be simply the only two-dimensional shapes of my own world, as I have always known it? Is it not obvious that your vaunted other world, so far from being the archetype, is a dream which borrows all its elements from this one?" It is of some importance to notice that the word symbolism is not adequate in all cases to cover the relation between the higher medium and its transposition in the lower. It covers some cases perfectly, but not others. Thus, the relation between speech and writing is one of symbolism. The written characters exist solely for the eye, the spoken words solely for the ear. There is complete discontinuity between them. They are not like one another, nor does the one cause the other to be. The one is simply a sign of the other, and signifies it by a convention. But a picture is not related to the visible world in just that way. Pictures are part of the visible world themselves, and represent it only by being part of it. Their visibility has the same source. The suns and lamps in pictures seem to shine only because real suns or lamps shine on them. That is, they seem to shine a great deal because they really shine a little in reflecting their archetypes. The sunlight in a picture is therefore not related to real sunlight simply as written words are to spoken. It is a sign, but also something more than a sign, and only a sign because it is also more than a sign, because in it the thing signified is really in a certain mode present. If I had to name the relation, I should call it not symbolical, but sacramental. But in the case we started from, that of emotion and sensation, we are even further beyond mere symbolism. For there, as we have seen, the very same sensation does not merely accompany, nor merely signify, diverse and opposite emotions, but becomes part of them. The emotion descends bodily, as it were, into the sensation and digests, transforms, and transubstantiates it, so that the same thrill along the nerves is delight or is agony. I am not going to maintain that what I call transposition is the only possible mode whereby a poorer medium can respond to a richer, but I claim that it is very hard to imagine any other. It is therefore, at the very least, not improbably that transposition occurs whenever the higher reproduces itself in the lower. Thus, to digress for a moment, it seems to me very likely that the real relation between mind and body is one of transposition. We are certain that, in this life at any rate, thought is intimately connected with the brain. The theory that thought, therefore, is merely a movement in the brain is, in my opinion, nonsense. For if so, that theory itself would be merely a movement, an event among atoms, which may have speed and direction, but of which it would be meaningless to use the words true or false. We are driven then to some kind of correspondence. But if we assume a one-for-one correspondence, well, this means that we attribute an almost unbelievable complexity and variety of events to the brain. But I submit that a one-for-one relation is probably quite unnecessary. All our examples suggest that the brain can respond, in a sense, adequately and exquisitely correspond to the seemingly infinite variety of consciousness, without providing one single physical modification for each single modification of consciousness. But that is a digression. Let us now return to our original question about spirit and nature, God and man. Our problem was that in what claims to be our spiritual life, all the elements of our natural life recur. And what is worse, it looks at first glance as if no other elements were present. We now see that if the spiritual is richer than the natural, as no one who believes in its existence would deny, then this is exactly what we should expect. And the skeptic's conclusion that the so-called spiritual is really derived from the natural, that is a mirage, or projection, or imaginary extension of the natural, is also exactly what we should expect. For as we have seen, this is the mistake that an observer who knew only the lower medium would be bound to make in every case of transposition. The brutal man never can by analysis find anything but lust in love. The flatlander never can find anything but flat shapes in a picture. Physiology never can find anything in thought except twitchings of the gray matter. It is no good browbeating the critic who approaches a transposition from below. On the evidence available to him, his conclusion is the only one possible. Everything is different when you approach transposition from above, as we all do in the case of emotion and sensation, or of the three-dimensional world and pictures, and as the spiritual man does in the case we are considering. Those who spoke with tongues, as St. Paul did, can well understand how that holy phenomenon differed from the hysterical phenomenon. Although, be it remembered, they were in a sense exactly the same phenomenon, just as the very same sensation came to Pepys in love, in the enjoyment of music, and in sickness. Spiritual things are spiritually discerned. The spiritual man judges all things, and is judged of none. But who dares to be a spiritual man? In the full sense, none of us. And yet we are somehow aware that we approach from above, or from inside, at least some of those transpositions which embody the Christian life in this world. With whatever sense of unworthiness, with whatever sense of audacity, we must affirm that we know a little of the higher system which is being transposed. In a way, the claim we are making is not a very startling one. We are only claiming to know that our apparent devotion, whatever else it may have been, was not simply erotic, or that our apparent desire for heaven, whatever else it might have been, was not simply a desire for longevity, or jewelry, or social splendors. Perhaps we have never really attained at all to what St. Paul would describe as spiritual life. But at the very least, we know, in some dim and confused way, that we were trying to use natural acts and images and language with a new value, have at least desired a repentance which was not merely prudential, and a love which was not self-centered. At the worst, we know enough of the spiritual to know that we have fallen short of it, as if the picture knew enough of the three-dimensional world to be aware that it was flat. It is not only for humility's sake, that, of course, that we must emphasize the dimness of our knowledge. I suspect that, save by God's direct miracle, spiritual experience can never abide introspection. If even our emotions will not do so, since the attempt to find out what we are now feeling yields nothing more than a physical sensation, much less will the operations of the Holy Ghost. The attempt to discover by introspective analysis our own spiritual condition is to me a horrible thing which reveals at best not the secret of God's spirit and ours, but their transpositions in intellect, emotion, and imagination, and which, at worst, may be the quickest road to presumption or despair. I believe that this doctrine of transposition provides for most of us a background very much needed for the theological virtue of hope. We can hope only for what we can desire. And the trouble is that any adult or philosophically respectable notion we can form of heaven is forced to deny of that state most of the things our nature desires. There is no doubt a blessedly ingenious faith, a child's or a savage's faith, which finds no difficulty. It accepts without awkward questionings the harps and golden streets and the family reunions pictured by hymn writers. Such a faith is deceived, yet, in the deepest sense, not deceived. For while it errs in mistaking symbol for fact, yet it apprehends heaven as joy and plenitude and love. But it is impossible for most of us, and we must not try, by artifice, to make ourselves more naive than we are. A man does not become as a little child by aping childhood. Hence our notion of heaven involves perpetual negations. No food, no drink, no sex, no movement, no mirth, no events, no time, no art. Against all these, to be sure, we set one positive, the vision and enjoyment of God. And since this is an infinite good, we hold rightly that it outweighs them all. That is, the reality of the beatific vision would or will outweigh, would infinitely outweigh, the reality of the negations. But can our present notion of it outweigh our present notion of them? Well, that is quite a different question. And for most of us, at most times, the answer is no. How it may be for great saints and mystics, I cannot tell. But for others, the conception of that vision is a difficult, precarious, and fugitive extrapolation from a very few and ambiguous moments in our earthly experience, while our idea of the negated natural goods is vivid and persistent, loaded with the memories of a lifetime, built into our nerves and muscles, and therefore into our imaginations. Thus the negatives have, so to speak, an unfair advantage in every competition with the positive. What is worse, their presence, and most when we most resolutely try to suppress or ignore them, vitiates even such a faint and ghost-like notion of the positive as we might have had. The exclusion of the lower goods begins to seem the essential characteristic of the higher good. We feel, if we do not say, that the vision of God will come not to fulfill but to destroy our nature. This bleak fantasy often underlies our very use of such words as holy, or pure, or spiritual. We must not allow this to happen if we can possibly prevent it. We must believe, and therefore in some degree imagine, that every negation will be only the reverse side of a fulfilling. And we must mean by that the fulfilling, precisely, of our humanity, not our transformation into angels, nor our absorption into deity. For though we shall be as the angels, and made like unto our master, I think this means like with the likeness proper to men, as different instruments that play the same air, but each in its own fashion. How far the life of the risen man will be sensory, we do not know, but I surmise that it will differ from the sensory, like we know here, not as emptiness differs from water or water from wine, but as flower differs from a bulb, or a cathedral from an architect's drawing. And it is here that transposition helps me. Let us construct a fable. Let us picture a woman thrown into a dungeon. There she bears and rears a son. He grows up seeing nothing but the dungeon walls, the straw on the floor, and a little patch of the sky seen through the grating, which is too high up to show anything except sky. This unfortunate woman was an artist, and when they imprisoned her, she managed to bring with her a drawing pad and a box of pencils. As she never loses the hope of deliverance, she is constantly teaching her son about the outer world, which he has never seen. She does it very largely by drawing him pictures. With her pencil, she attempts to show him what fields, rivers, mountains, cities, and waves on a beach are like. He is a dutiful boy, and he does his best to believe her when she tells him that the outer world is far more interesting and glorious than anything in the dungeon. At times he succeeds. On the whole, he gets on tolerably well until one day he says something that gives his mother pause. For a minute or two, they are at a cross purposes. Finally, it dawns on her that he has, all these years, lived under a misconception. "But," she gasps, "you didn't think that the real world was full of lines drawn in a lead pencil." "What?" says the boy. "No pencil marks there?" And instantly his whole notion of the outer world becomes a blank, for the lines by which alone he was imagining it have now been denied of it. He has no idea of that which will exclude and dispense with the lines, that of which the lines were merely a transposition. The waving treetops, the light dancing on the weir, the colored three-dimensional realities, which are not enclosed in lines, but define their own shapes at every moment with a delicacy and multiplicity which no drawing could ever achieve. The child will get the idea that the real world is somehow less visible than his mother's pictures. In reality, it lacks lines because it is incomparably more visible. So with us, we know not what we shall be, but we may be sure we shall be more, not less, than we were on earth. Our natural experiences, sensory, emotional, imaginative, are only like the drawing, like penciled lines on flat paper. If they vanish in the risen life, they will vanish only as pencil lines vanish from the real landscape, not as a candle flame that is put out, but as a candle flame which becomes invisible because someone has pulled up the blind, thrown open the shutters, and lit in the blaze of the risen sun. You can put it whichever way you please. You can say that by transposition, our humanity, senses and all, can be made the vehicle of beatitude. Or you can say that the heavenly bounties by transposition are embodied during this life in our temporal experience. But the second way is better. It is the present life, which is the diminution, the symbol, the etiolated, the, as it were, vegetarian substitute. If flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom, that is not because they are too solid, too gross, too distinct, too illustrious with being. They are too flimsy, too transitory, too phantasmal. With this, my case, as the lawyers say, is complete. But I have just 4 points to add. Number one, I hope it is quite clear that the conception of transposition, as I call it, is distinct from another conception often used for the same purpose. I mean the conception of development. The developmentalist explains the continuity between things that claim to be spiritual and things that are certainly natural by saying that the one slowly turned into the other. I believe this view explains some facts, but I think it has been much overworked. At any rate, it is not the theory I am putting forward. I am not saying that the natural act of eating after millions of years somehow blossoms into the Christian sacrament. I am saying that the spiritual reality which existed before there were any creatures who ate gives this natural act a new meaning. And more than a new meaning, makes it in a certain context to be a different thing. In a word, I think that real landscapes enter into pictures, not that pictures will one day sprout into real trees and grass. Number two, I have found it impossible, in thinking of what I call transposition, not to ask myself whether it may help us to conceive the incarnation. Of course, if transposition was merely a mode of symbolism, it could give us no help at all in this matter. On the contrary, it would lead us wholly astray, back into a new kind of docetism, or would it be only the old kind, and away from the utterly historical and concrete reality, which is the center of all our hope, faith, and love. But then, as I have pointed out, transposition is not always symbolism. In varying degrees, the lower reality can actually be drawn into the higher and become part of it. The sensation which accompanies joy becomes itself joy. We can hardly choose but say, incarnates joy. If this is so, then I venture to suggest, though with great doubt and in the most provisional way, that the concept of transposition may have some contribution to make to the theology, or at least to the philosophy, of the Incarnation. For we are told in one of the creeds that the Incarnation worked not by conversion of the Godhead into flesh, but by taking of the manhood into God. And it seems to me that there is a real analogy between this and what I have called transposition, that humanity, still remaining itself, is not merely counted as, but veritably drawn into deity. Seems to me like what happens when a sensation, not in itself pleasure, is drawn into the joy it accompanies. But I walk in the mirabilibus supra me, and submit all to the verdict of real theologians. Number 3. I have tried to stress throughout the inevitableness of the error made about every transposition by one who approaches it from the lower medium only. The strength of such a critic lies in the words merely, or nothing but. He sees all the facts, but not the meaning. Quite truly, therefore, he claims to have seen all the facts. There is nothing else there, except the meaning. He is therefore, as regards the matter in hand, in the position of an animal. You will have noticed that most dogs cannot understand pointing. You point to a bit of food on the floor. The dog, instead of looking at the floor, sniffs at your finger. A finger is a finger to him, but that is all. His world is all facts and no meaning. And in a period when factual realism is dominant, we shall find people deliberately inducing upon themselves this dog-like mind. A man who has experienced love from within will deliberately go about to inspect it analytically from outside and regard the results of this analysis as truer than his experience. The extreme limit of this self-binding is seen in those who, like the rest of us, have consciousness, yet go about to study the human organism as if they did not know it was conscious. As long as this deliberate refusal to understand things from above, even where such understanding is possible, continues, it is idle to talk of any final victory over materialism. The critique of every experience from below, the voluntary ignoring of meaning and concentration on fact, will always have the same plausibility. There will always be evidence, and every month fresh evidence, to show that religion is only psychological, justice only self-protection, politics only economics, love only lust, and thought itself only cerebral biochemistry. And 4. Finally, I suggest that what has been said of transposition throws a new light on the doctrine of the resurrection of the body. For in a sense, transposition can do anything. However great the difference between spirit and nature, between aesthetic joy and that fluttering in the diaphragm, between reality and picture, yet the transposition can be in its own way adequate. I said before that in your drawing, you had only plain white paper for sun and cloud, snow, water, and human flesh. In one sense, how miserably inadequate, yet in another, how perfect. If the shadows are properly done, that patch of white paper will, in some curious way, be very like blazing sunshine. We shall almost feel cold while we look at the paper snow, and almost warm our hands at the paper fire. May we not, by a reasonable analogy, suppose likewise that there is no experience of the spirit so transcendent and supernatural, no vision of deity himself so close and so far beyond all images and emotions, that to it also there cannot be an appropriate correspondence on the sensory level, not by a new sense, but by the incredible flooding of those very sensations we now have with a meaning, a transvaluation, of which we have here no faintest guess.